Good evening, everybody. How are we doing tonight? My name is Octavian. I am joined by Brian Starkey on the desk here, and we're going to be getting into game one here between McMaster and NJIT. Hopefully everything is operating correctly on the stream end. Been hearing some very disturbing tales of technical issues. I'm trying my best to keep everything under control here, but we've got a pretty standard spread across the river from both teams, and I'm going to toss it over to Brian while I try and get everything under control.
Yeah, so I'll take some pressure off Octavian here, maybe give you guys a fascinating tale of level one League of Legends, which is we're going to have a five-man spread out across the river, and absolutely nothing is going to happen. Not even any deep wards. NJIT is going to put a ward up at the entrance into their bottom side jungle, but it really is probably not going to spot anyone out because it's only going to last for about another 20 seconds or so. And, you know, not a whole lot's going to be happening. We see some pretty normal starts, at least coming out from Grave, starting his blue buff right away. Kha'Zix for the side of McMaster is going to be starting his blue buff as well. So they're actually going to be on opposite sides of the map when they go to gank, unless they do some interesting jungle paths that aren't your typical ones. We do see that sometimes. To kind of help them get a little bit more of an advantage. Tall White Bro is getting some good poke down onto Moosterman. Autumn Clouds is doing a very good job of using that Targon, the Relic Shield, I'm sorry, the Relic Shield to kind of help his ADC out, get some CS for him and some CS for himself at the same time.
All right, it seems like everything's in order. Apologies for the slight stutter there. I think my internet was just having something of an issue, but seems to be going very smoothly now, and we will be getting into the beginnings of a split game here as well. As I really can't call this one way or the other, just looking at the standings. These teams have yet to meet up with one another, as we have a meetup in the top lane between Django and Tyroxide. Django, though, not having leveled up, it seems, the Devourer yet. Or no, he used it on the minion early on in that fight. Okay, it was on cooldown. And he didn't actually manage to go for the Devourer onto Tyroxide even after three stacks were available.
Yeah, and that's the one thing that's really obnoxious, actually, about playing into that Tahm Kench, is you think that you're safe when you're at range, but you're still not because he can throw your own minion at you to do some damage. Actually, AP damage, too. And he can devour you if you get close enough to do percent health AP damage, which also sucks pretty bad.
It's quite useful into the matchup matchups, and into just tank matchups in general. It's not really highly repeatable percent health damage, as early on, the devourer is on quite a long cooldown. Another attempted hook there. But it's there nonetheless, and it may give a slight edge over to Django.
Yeah, I agree, and I think the thing is about Tahm Kench in the top lane is his AP damage is surprising. You don't really expect it, especially if he starts building those tank items and he gets the farm that he needs to from the CS. He can stack his health really well, and a lot of his stuff is just based on being able to get the items he needs, get the health he needs to then have like AP damage. He deals out AP damage based on the amount of health that he has available as well. I think that starts with his ultimate, if I remember correctly.
It used to actually start with his ultimate. They moved the power around a little bit at this point, so that the ulti no longer has that passive attached to it, and it's a slightly weaker version than what it was on release, but he just has the passive from the start of the game now. So it allows him to be stronger in a solo lane, which is, I think, what Riot was going for with that change. One of the reasons why we might see Django bringing this to the top lane. A bit of an unusual choice for sure.
Yeah, I agree. Although into the Maokai, like we were talking about, it may not be such a bad pick. Because Maokai is pretty damage heavy, but Django, since he is playing on that Tahm Kench, he does get that that shield that allows him to regenerate health after he takes damage. A certain amount of it, at least, and that helps him survive a little bit longer, at least against a more damage heavy top.
Oh, there's the stun from the Empowered Tongue Lash. Tyroxide flashes away, but it's a flash forward for Django, and the gray health will bring him out from under the turret and into safety. 400 gold in his pockets.
Yeah, that was a really good gank by Han Solo there. Really good rotation seeing him start in that top lane.
You could say that Han Solo ganked first.
Oh no.
You could say that.
Is it good? Promise no more bad jokes, Octavian.
But I break all of my promises. It's good that you learned that early as a co-caster, because really, I'm just a terrible person, and you probably won't want to work with me in the future. But I'll take advantage of you while you're here. Don't worry. And yeah, I'll take advantage of you by throwing terrible references and jokes at you. I don't think that one was that bad, though. I was holding on to that for, like, the whole series. If he wasn't the first one to gank this game, I was going to do it next game.
You were hoping.
I had engineered that one back when I first saw this player's name. That's how deep the rabbit hole goes. But we've got action potentially in the bottom lane. Actually, an interaction that I didn't know existed has come to light this game. As we manage to get back to that in just a moment here, though. Django landing another stun on Terroxide. Going to be following it up with the percentage chunk. But the trade is about even so far. And Terroxide does have his own sustain in the form of Sap Magic.
Yeah, the stat magic is actually, it's pretty sweet, especially in team fights when everyone's throwing spells out. That's part of the reason why Maokai can stay alive for so long during team fights, is because he just keeps auto-attacking you and getting a bit of his health back each time, just because so many spells are flying around. I think it's a 4-stack, if I remember correctly.
That's why Maokai in Earth is my favorite thing.
Yes!
You get so many stacks of sap magic, but that's a bit of an aside. The interaction that I was talking about earlier, though, that I actually do want to highlight, one of the reasons maybe why we saw the Thresh pick, we've seen once or twice Autumn Clouds going up just for the empowered auto attack onto Sho, or Sha, I'm not sure how exactly he wants his name pronounced, and just the magic damage enhanced auto off of Thresh's Flay passive actually pops Malzahar's spell shield, which is something I didn't realize it would do, because I don't think it pops any other spell shield effects in the game.
Yeah, it definitely doesn't do Banshees, for sure. Yeah, actually, that would make a lot of sense, because it is empowered off his Flay, right? Yeah. So yeah, off of his Flay, and doing the damage that way, yeah. That's a pretty cool interaction. Yeah, good catch. I didn't really think about that. And it looks like Django might want to try to get Terroxide again?
Django's just playing a very aggressive lane here. It's not worked out for him, aside from that kill, though. I mean, you gotta say, First Blood, pretty good. That's certainly a good result. But I want to give some props to Terroxide. He's done his best of holding his own and even surpassing Django in terms of CS. So he's certainly not out of the game by any means. And I wouldn't say that Tahm Kench is the kind of laner that can roll over a game with an early lead. So even despite that First Blood going over to McMaster, this game still holds decidedly pretty even. Especially given that NJIT are now going for the first straight.
Yeah, and that's actually really big for them. The first Infernal Drake is really, really nice. You typically don't see that start to stack up. I think it's until probably around that first or second item, pretty much your second item, if I remember correctly, when you really start to see the effects of the first Infernal Drake. But if NJIT has a lead by the time that starts to take into effect, it's definitely a nice little snowball. It does give you that snowball potential.
Yeah. So even though they are behind a little bit in gold, we should keep in mind that they have that Drake advantage at this point. I think first turret is still going to be quite a big pot of gold for whoever can grab that one, though neither side is anywhere near close to that. And the match is slower than I anticipated, but actually falling slightly in favor of McMaster at this point.
Yeah, and something I want to point out is that McMaster is doing an excellent job. They took advantage of the fact that they lost that first Infernal Drake, but they put a lot of really good wards up on the map, at least on the top side jungle. They have a deep control ward right below that second tier turret in the top lane, and also a good control ward in the top lane river. Both those are really, really big. It'll allow you to spot out Graves if he's coming through, and Corki is basically protected on both sides now.
As no R in that name, is looking to clear out a bit of that vision. Not the most impressive use of the package I've ever seen, but it was about to time out there, so using it for a bit of mobility back to the lane. And, you know, we gotta give some props to Nito, though, as he is part of the reason why McMaster is beginning to pull ahead a bit here, as he's got actually a fairly significant lead now into Villarota's Jace pick.
Yeah, the 12 CS up is actually really, really big. Both of them have gone back once, I believe. Jace about to go back for his second time, sitting on 1,600 gold. That's actually really, that's really good for him. He should be able to, got the phage and also got the Warhammer to help that up. Django!
Django finds himself deep in enemy territory. Using the Grey Hall at the last moment is going to buy as much time as possible. Flashes away, but there's the collateral damage hero, not letting that one slip away so easily. Han Solo, though, coming up to the top side, is going to find a face full of damage as well, and it's a double kill over to the Graves. Meanwhile, Ahoka is going to be neutralized by Sho's passive. And it's two kills going over to the side of NJIT that'll pull them right back into the match.
Yeah, I mean, that was... I don't know what Django was doing so deep there, especially with the amount of health that he had. Maybe he thought that Han Solo was going to be able to get there in time to maybe try...
Passive this time, and Sho's going to get pulled back. The exhaust down as well, and there's absolutely no hope of getting out of that terrible situation as Autumn Clouds gets the benefit of a heal from Tall White Bro just to make sure he's safely pulled out of the fight, but Mooster Man is looking for the continuation of this skirmish. The third bullet doesn't find its mark as Autumn Clouds makes his way out of the ult just in time. Duroxide, having teleported down, is not going to find a mark either. All summoners down from the side of McMaster's bottom lane, but they still come out with a kill.
Yeah, AoH Django actually used his teleport to get back into the top lane, so even if he wanted to, he couldn't have followed. But that does give him a lot of good power pressure and a chance to get a little bit more farm up on top of this Maokai. Teroxide maybe going to be put a little bit farther behind because of that teleport that he didn't get anything for. And AoH Django should have, they should have TP advantage, if only by a couple seconds, once that's back up again, though.
Yeah, and that's unfortunate for Teroxide and for NGIT as a whole. We are kind of in need of a way back into this match. They're starting to falter a bit. There's the Devourer onto Teroxide as Django looks to proxy farm a little bit, and actually, my god, gets a good amount of damage down.
Yeah, I mean, Teroxide was not trying to fight as much as he was trying to run away from that.
Oh, there's the flash in. Nato going to be just aggressed upon something horrible here. The Malefic Vision is burning, and Hero with the red buff claims the killing spree. Teleport down now from Django, or rather just the ulti, in fact. Gold mobility one way or the other, though. Hero going to fall as the shutdown goes to Han Solo, who was drastically in need of that. Sho gets pulled back, the Devourer as well, to hold him up a little bit longer. And two more kills get claimed by McMaster.
Yeah, really good rotations by McMaster. AoH Django using his ult to get into that mid lane really, really fast, able to help out. I was worried that Han Solo was maybe a little bit too deep and was going to die there. He lost a bit of his health pretty quickly, but he also took away a bunch of health from Hero as well. Mm-hmm. So that's the power of Kha'Zix right there, man. The spicy turnaround.
And off the back of that, Nato was able to pick up a Trinity Force. He was the first one to go down in the fight, but nonetheless, from his quick return to the base, we see him grab a very powerful item spike in the mid-game here. 13-minute Triforce is nothing to be scoffed at. Matched to some degree by Velorota's Black Cleaver. But I feel like Corki, already somewhat dominating in this lane, is just going to fall further out of control now.
Yeah, I think so too. The Sheen proc off of that Trinity Force onto Jace with that long range poke from Corki's ultimate is going to be very, very annoying for Jace. Even though he has that Black Cleaver that gives him a little bit of extra health, it's really not enough to kind of help keep him alive, I guess, in this lane. And, woo, Tall White Bro just barely making it away from that Malzahar Q.
He had no fear. He trusted in the base. He trusted and was rewarded for his faith, so.
You just have to believe.
You really do. Tall White Bro believe, in fact. And Dragon is once again on lock here on the side of NJIT. Huh? This time there might be a little bit of a contest as Kha'Zix is roaming down through the mid lane. Dragon down to about half health, however. They've got to act quickly if McMaster want to be part of this fight, as there's the deadly flourish. Han Solo, though, had not been marked previously, and so the snare doesn't come through. Autumn Cloud's coming in, is going to find a face full of the enemy team as he falls pretty quickly, but Teroxide is not quite as tanky as he thought he was. Piercing Arrow doesn't land onto the Malzahar. Curtain Call flying through as well, but Io's Django is looking to finish what his team started. A Tongue Lash onto the Malzahar claims life, and Velorota, whose name I cannot work my tongue around, is going to fall as well. There's the blast cone to get Nato closer to the kill. And Django is going to have to back out. Doesn't want to dive two turrets.
Yeah, you don't want to be, even if you're Tom Kench, you don't want to be that deep, right? You still have to kind of respect the gen a little bit.
In the end, Dragon doesn't go down. So rotates to the mid instead.
Yeah, and that actually, I was going to say, if that dragon had gotten taken, I would have said that was still hashtag worth. If you look at the top lane, before AO's Django teleported down into that mid lane for that fight, he actually did get the top lane turret. So they got first turret gold off of that. All 650 of it going in to the Tahm Kench. He's currently sitting at 6.4k total gold. And that's just, that's crazy. And they also took that mid lane turret. So, I mean, that's two turrets, good kills, and they didn't lose the dragon. Very, very well done by McMaster University during that fight.
Yeah. I mean, I mentioned earlier that Tahm Kench isn't exactly known for his ability to snowball a game out of control, but if you get enough of a lead, you can do that on almost anybody. And IOH Django certainly played very aggressively in that last fight, using his ulti to get into three members of the enemy team and barely taking a dent in the process. This is going to be McMaster going to the Dragon Pit once again. And this time, however, there won't be much of a contest.
Yeah, at this point, you're just kind of looking at, if you're NJIT, you have to really kick your fights. You have to say, man, when do we want to engage, and what is our ideal engage, and how do we find that? Because right now, unless you have your ideal engage, this game is going to snowball out of control, like you were saying, because they're getting the leads they need to. I mean, Varus, 2-0-3, already has that Yomu's Ghostblade built at 16 minutes. And he's already building up into that serrated dagger. He's got the Seer of the Goddess. You have to be really smart about how you play now if you're NJIT.
Yeah, and this is such a pressured moment as well for NJIT, because not only are they just behind in terms of golden objectives, but I'd also say they're behind compositionally at this point in the game, because this is when Corki and Varus come online. They get those first few items, Corki in particular, and they spike so very hard in the mid game because of things like Trinity Force and Yumus. And we're seeing McMaster take advantage of it. They're getting deep vision, they're looking for potential fights, and they're playing aggressively.
Yeah, and I think a lot of that has to do with their confidence that they have in their Tahm Kench, and also in Autumn Clouds. He's been landing a lot of really good hooks and has been following them up, and his team has been right on top of him to help him out. I mean, that's the one big problem about playing any champion that has like a hook or something that requires a follow-up, because if your team is not on the same page, you are in a bad spot.
I feel like Hero could very much be caught out here. He's going for the 1v1 with Nato, but Nato has the exhaust to buy time, and Autumn Clouds and Tall Wiper are both coming from the bottom lane. And yes, indeed, the Graves bit off a little more than he could chew, but speaking of biting off, Django's going to be taking a bite out of Tarak's side. Probably tastes a little bit woody, but in the end, he's fine with it, claims the killing spree. And the fourth shot not going to do nearly enough damage for Autumn Clouds to fall. That's 2-0 trade going over to McMaster.
And that's another case where we see AO's Django getting the flank and pinching two members of NJIT, just pinching them down. Ooh. Oh no!
Speaking of Django, that's an aggressive flash over the wall. And I think he's just doing everything he can at this point to make me feel silly for saying that a Tahm Kench can't be the carry.
Yeah, because right now he's got 4 kills, only 1 death, 2 assists, and 128 CS. I mean, that's extremely impressive. And he's putting those 4 kills to very good use. Rushing that Sunfire Cape, rushing that Spectre's Cowl, getting the Magic Tread Boots. He really wants to tank up, and he wants to be in your face. He's not messing around.
Mm-hmm. Well, what do you do here, then, if you're on NJIT? What's the answer to this question that seems to be more and more impossible to answer? McMaster, they have quite a bit of a lead, but is it insurmountable at this point?
I think it's close, because if you look at the team comp of NJIT, they kind of, I don't really know what they're trying to accomplish with their composition, right? They have one tank, they have Jace in the mid lane who can poke really well, and they have, you know, Jhin as the ADC who can help engage, and Sho can flash ult, but I mean, too many members of McMaster University are pretty far ahead. Oh no.
Eroded, pulled back into the fight by another well-placed hook from Autumn Clouds, and Han Solo will easily finish off the straggling Jace. That's another kill for McMaster.
Yeah, and that's the case I was talking about with Autumn Clouds. He's so on point with landing those hooks and able to follow up. I mean, he missed Sho, but he hit Jace. I mean, I'm not sure if he was aiming for Sho and just kind of got lucky and hit Jace, or if it was like, hey, I'm going to pretend like I'm going for Malzahar, but I'm actually not.
Yeah, even a little rough for Sho there, because he did have his Void passive up. If he had been hit with that hook, it wouldn't have been followed up on. Autumn Clouds wouldn't have landed the CC. But Sho dodging meant that the hook landed on Camilla Rhoda, and it's just all around an unfortunate situation. It's another kill going over to McMaster, and at this point, they don't really even need it. That's a flash wave from Autumn Clouds, though. This is a a good start to a potential skirmish, but it looks like McMaster are out of there.
Yeah, and that would have been the picks that you wanted. You know, being able to get the Varus and get the Thresh, leaving you as a 4v5 and forcing Tom Kench to just kind of hang out there and not be able to come in and pinch you for the fight is something that you want to do, especially because AO's Jango has been doing such a great job of getting those flank ultimates down.
And something I think I gotta at least mention, I don't really want to harp on this, but earlier in the game, we saw Hero, actually, back when the game was 4-4 and not 11-4, Hero had a 2-0 KDA, and since that point, he's managed to die 3 times and only get 1 more kill for himself. So the Graves jungle having less of an impact than perhaps they would have liked, certainly less of an impact than Han Solo's Kha'Zix has. I don't know how much of that I want to put down to the pick. Graves isn't really something you see too often nowadays, how much of that I want to put down to the player. But one way or another, I think we need to see more come out of the jungle in Game 2. Because at this point, maybe you do want to start thinking about Game 2.
If I was NJIT, that's what I would be doing right now, too. It's like, where did we go wrong in the last game? And Rock'Side getting caught.
Yeah, the Flay going to be pulling him back. He's inside a box of pain and death as well. And, oh, man, even with the flash, there's just nowhere that he could go that was safe anymore. The hook flies out, but it doesn't quite land the second time around. Still there, 1 kill taken for the side of McMaster as they see the way of blue buff and go for a tower.
And I think that is also, that's a point where I don't think NJIT they needed to contest. Like, it's just the blue buff. At this point, you have bigger fish to fry, more specifically the Tom Catfish.
Hey, that was pretty good. That was a pretty good one, yeah.
I've been hearing you and Corvus just say bad jokes over and over again is encouraging.
Oh, it rubs off, All right, well, Drake is up again. They've got a dragon to fry at this point, and it will be a mountain dragon, and they're going to fry it very, very quickly. I wonder what that tastes like. They don't have to, but I do.
It's probably like chewy.
We'll go with chewy. I don't have any basis for that. Don't think dragons actually exist. I hate to break it to you.
No, don't be like this.
But Mountain Drake exists and is taken by McMaster. That's their second, actually, of the game. Mountain Drake is one of those dragons that once you get more than one of them, heaven forbid, once you get 3 of them even, global objectives just fall so very quickly. It's one of the ones that works really, really well with itself if you can stack it up.
Yeah, and that's, 20% additional true damage to neutral objectives, like Hubuli, or I'm sorry, tower objectives. That's just, oof. Mm-hmm. Not good. Han Solo.
He's checking the wrong bush. Doesn't get too punished for it though. Half his health gone. Pretty significant, but he can base. It's okay.
Yeah, not as big as if he had died, because then that would have given NJIT the potential to maybe try to fight, maybe try to go and win a fight, maybe contest the Baron even if they wanted to. Wouldn't recommend that. Just their team fight is still too weak to do a full on team fight without maybe getting a pick or at least a more favorable engage than what we've seen in the past.
Would stalling be favorable for them though at this point? Like, how do you see the comps matching up should this game go another 20 minutes? Because Kha'Zix, Varus, these are picks that certainly don't fall off in the end game.
Right, so Kha'Zix and Varus, you're right, don't fall off. Jhin gets stronger for sure. Jace does get stronger. Graves gets kind of strong, but really you're looking at your Jhin and your Jace as your two primary sources of damage on the side of NJIT, and maybe giving them chance to ramp up will be better, but at the same time, you have to keep in mind that AOS Jango is gonna keep tanking up on that Tahm Kench, and Thresh he continues to get tanky too, just because of his passive, able to pick up the souls and get armor and AP resist just from that. So it's one of those things that maybe stalling would work, but you'd have to go on a lot longer than 30 minutes, I would think.
And of course, you'd have to be able to stall in the first place, which McMaster is playing fast and loose enough that I don't think it's going to be an answer. As they continue to aggressively push for vision on the top side here, trying to get control of the Baron's bit. Han Solo could be in some real trouble here, though. Villarota doesn't have quite enough damage to be a threat, and Tahm Kench is pulled into the back lines of the fight. Villarota now trapped in the Raptor bit, trying to disguise himself as a jungle camp. They're not going to fall for it, though, as Jango is happily tanking up the entirety of the enemy team while they deal with that Jace, and it's a cleanup crew for McMaster. Just 1 kill left, and they will find it. Tall White Bro easily fells the Oak, and it's a push down the mid lane.
Yep, probably gonna get the inhibitor off of this for sure. Death timers are pretty long. You're looking at 19 seconds on Jin and 20 seconds on Graves. Maybe they try to do something more, but I would doubt it. Maybe they rotate back, set up Baron Vision again, maybe try to do that once Han Solo comes back. So that was the kind of the fight that we were talking about. They got the pick on Han Solo, but then they couldn't decide if they actually wanted to keep fighting or not. And I think that was one of their big mistakes. There is, you need to know that, oh, hey, we got a pick, we should back out. We don't want to fight this because we're still not strong enough yet.
Jango was just allowed to soak up so much damage in that fight. I think they burned through his health bar literally twice because he got down to about a quarter health before he popped the gray health. He almost literally had double the effective health. That's sort of the benefit of Tahm Kench in the endgame. We also didn't see him base until after that Baron was taken, so he lost nearly all of his health in the fight, and then for the Baron take, he was back at full. I'd just like to point out that he did that, which is kind of silly. Just a little silly. But that's Spirit Visage Tahm Kench. With a red.
Yeah, basically. I mean, 515, 195 CS Tahm Kench.
That is the point at which things can get silly.
Yes. Things are really starting to get silly now. I kind of actually... Let's take a look at Tahm Kench right now. So he has 144 AD and 50 AP. That 50 AP, and I guess most of the AD is coming from having that Baron. But still, that's pretty nuts, considering he has 218 armor and 260 magic resist with this Baron buff on. I don't know if NJIT really wants to try to do anything when this Baron buff is up. I mean, you can try to defend, but maybe you're best off just trying to turtle, but you don't have the wave clear because you have only one Jace.
And they've got double Mountain Drake. Like, turtling is going to be so very hard. Corki just needs to land a few Sheen-empowered auto-attacks on a turret for it to have some very serious pain. Jace eliminated off the face of the rift as Han Solo's going to be pulled out of it. Any real danger. Ayo, it's Jango just tanking up the turret this whole time. He's been hit by tens, dozens of turret shots at this point, and he simply does not care. The top lane inhibitor turret will follow the top lane inhibitor soon to follow. Flash forward for the auto tall white bro claims another life. And meanwhile, Tahm Kench.
So, if I was NJIT, maybe I would ban out Tahm Kench.
Maybe, I mean, Jango certainly had quite a powerful performance, but you've got to look at some of the heroes that we've sung less about as casters this game. Nito has the same scoreline, actually a little bit better by 4 assists there. And, I mean, there's a 4-0 AD carry as well. I don't know if specific bans are the answer. Something has to change in the draft, but I don't think they can target this many players.
No, I don't think so either. And I think you're right in praising the other characters, but I think a lot of the snowball that we saw started in that top lane. Mm-hmm. Because it gave Han Solo that early assist, gave him the chance to start roaming around, and we just didn't see Hero that often either, trying to come around and do any counter ganks either. So maybe you're right. Maybe it's not just one ban that they need, but maybe it's just kind of overall, they need to pay attention to their team composition a little bit more and be more purposeful about what they're trying to do in the game.
All right. Well, we're going to be getting into game two as soon as possible, everybody. Give us just a few minutes here while we get the lobby set up. And don't go anywhere, because we're going to be right back.